Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Today I'm going to circle back around and pick up where I was talking about how suicide is not the unforgivable sin, and that if someone commits suicide, that does not mean they are automatically sent to a place of eternal conscious torment, a place which the American churches call hell. During this long teaching that I'm embarking on, what I'm starting to do first is build a foundation that, you know, Christianity isn't just a private little country club where people who confess with their mouth that they're a sinner and accept Jesus as their Savior are the only people that can ever be saved. I think the biggest error that the church has ever taught is that we have limited God to being able to work with people while they are in their flesh and blood living in this earth, and that once they die, their eternity is set and can never be altered or changed. Now, what I'm wanting to do is to show you that when we start believing one wrong thing and we lay that foundation, then we build more and more and more wrong doctrines on top of it, which would be the unforgivable sin, being suicide, and anybody that commits suicide has to go to the place called hell, and they have to be there forever and ever. I am going to just strategically try to go through and teach, and you know, guys, I may be on this type of subject as far as the false, and I did say false doctrine. I said false doctrine of a place called hell. Okay, there is a judgment, there is a punishment, with the long-term end goal of God, okay, for correction, okay? See, we lose that in churches. We think that there's this angry God that's just got to get even with people, and we are the people that are standing between this angry God and other people in the earth, and so I've got to get to them so they can make things right with God before they die. Do you know that makes me their Savior, not Jesus? Let's think on these things, okay? Our purpose here is not to try to keep an angry God from throwing people in hell, okay? Jesus came to save us from sin and death. He did not come to save us from His Father. We need to think about some things. Okay, so what I want to do today, I'm going to just pick back up because I'm laying this foundation that Jesus is the victor. Jesus is our reconciliation to God the Father. All things will be reconciled to God, and God will be all in all at some point in the future. Okay, now people who don't know Jesus in this lifetime, for God to be a just and fair God, right, they have to come face to face with their Creator, Jesus, and they have to come face to face with truth, because that only gives them the opportunity to know truth and know that they've lived a lie. Okay, an unjust God would just say, oh, well, I gave you a chance in that 32 years you were alive, and then that car wreck when you died at 32, nobody had told you about me, so it's off to the flame. I said this the other day in one of my teachings. I said, did you know that the game of Monopoly is actually fairer, more fair than who we portray God to be? Because at least in the Monopoly game, you get a chance to get out of hell, right? I mean, out of jail. But in Christianity, what we teach, which, by the way, came into the church through St. Augustine about 600 years after the cross. 600 years. For 600 years, the entire church knew that Jesus was the Savior of the entire world, the whole world. John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Not a few people here and there. No, Jesus drug away all of the sin of the world. Now, this will take time. There's a scripture. It says God is not slow, as some people see Him as being slow or slack, right? But that it is His will, it is what He wants, that all men would come to a knowledge of truth, okay? And I'm proposing to you that God's plan of redemption in Genesis, when Adam and Eve fell in the garden, the rebellion, that He had a perfect plan of redemption. What would be fair about God throwing people in hell because of what Adam did. All right, so let me start teaching now. I'm going to go back to 1 Corinthians 15, 21 and 28. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also came through a man. Just as in Adam, all die. Now, we understand that, right? I'm going to stop and ask you, do you realize that every human being that has ever lived has died at some point up till now? Right? So, this is a true scripture. For as in Adam, all die. Also, in Christ, all will be given life. All will live. Okay. But each in his own order. Okay, so let's stop and talk about that. So we don't have a problem with accepting that every human being will absolutely die because of not what they did, but because of what Adam did, right? So why do we have a problem believing this scripture word for word in the Greek? There's no wordplay here, guys. This is just what scripture says in all 150 Bibles I've read it in. In Jesus Christ, all will live. All will be given life. Okay, so if all is true in Adam, all will be given life in Jesus. Okay, so what we say when we believe that Adam and what he does without our permission will send everybody to hell automatically, unless we confess Jesus with our mouth, what we're saying is the power of what Adam did without our permission overrides what Jesus did without our permission. See, it's really not about an individual. It is about the entire creation, right? And it's about that one head, that one man who brought all of mankind down into death, sin and death. Watch. Through one man, sin and death entered the world, right? Okay, so it's sin and death. Can I stop and ask you something about hell? I'll just throw this in for free today. In Genesis, when God told Adam that if he ate from the tree, he would die, God did not look at Adam and say, when you eat from this tree, you will go to hell. No. He said that Adam would die. So see, through Adam, all mankind die because Adam opened the doorway for sin and death. Through Jesus, Jesus is going to overcome and defeat sin and death, and he is going to bring all things back to its original creation. It may not be in a person's lifetime here, but it will happen. Let me read a little bit more. Down here in verse 28, it says, then the Son himself will be subject to the Father, the one giving him all things, subjecting all things to Jesus, in order that God may be all in all. Now watch. The Passion Translation says that God may be in everything and everyone. Okay, so this is a consummation of reconciliation of the entire creation back to the way that God created it to be. Okay, I'm going to read you, let me go ahead down and read a little bit more. This is Romans 5:18 and 19. So then, as it was through one trespass resulting in a verdict of condemnation for all people, so also it was through one righteous act resulting in a declaration of righteousness issuing in life for all people. For just as though the disobedience of one man, the many were made sinners, also through the obedience of the one, the many will be made righteous ones. Okay, so the effect that Adam had, okay, brought all of mankind, and not just mankind, all of creation into a place of futility, right? Death, sin, death, all of this. Okay, what Jesus did and is still doing and will continue to do until he is the victor, he will bring all things back into submission. Now, here's the thing, too. That's all I'm going to read right now. But what I do want to do is I want to read you some more quotes. Okay, if we go all the way back, okay, to the closest men who sat with Jesus, walked with Jesus, and the men that sat under the apostles that spent time with Jesus, and the people that sat under the men that sat under the apostles. Those first 300 or 400 years of people, don't you believe possibly that they actually knew the gospel message better than someone in the 1600s or even in the year 2000? I would think so. People that sit down and actually eat with me know me better than someone 600 years later, 1600 years later, or 2000 years later. Guys, this is biblical right here. Everything I'm teaching you is biblical. I'm telling you, even the book of Revelation, it is misread and mistranslated. But that lake of fire that we think God's going to throw people in so he can burn them forever is not true. That is a refiner's fire where he's burning away all of their impurities and making them pure like they were when they were created in the beginning. Our word fire comes from the Greek word pure, P-U-R. That's where we get our English word pure or purify. Many times when we cook something, what are we doing? We're purifying it, right? We're putting it in a skillet or a pan over a flame because we're going to cook out those impurities. That's where the word fire comes from in our English from the Greek. It's P-U-R, pure. Okay, but from here I want to read you some more of the early church leaders. We call them church fathers, but actually, you know, that's an injustice because there were women in church leadership that people just want to push under the dust and pretend like it never happened. But I'm going to read two or three quotes to you today. This is by Gregory of Nyssa. And it says, "For it is evident that God will in truth be all in all." I just read that to you today. "When there shall be no evil in existence, when every created being is at harmony with itself, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. When every creature shall have been made one body." And this is in between the time of 335 and 390 is when this quote was done. Now, I'm going to give you a quote from Clement of Alexandria. Clement of Alexandria was the overseer of the Christian theological school in Alexandria, okay? There was six different ones that taught theology, and all of them taught that there would be a consummation of all things reconciled back to God, every person that ever lived at some point, whether in this life or the afterlife, would be reconciled to God the Father through the work of Jesus Christ. And only one of those six, if you want to call them seminaries, taught anything any different, and guess where it was located? You got it, in Rome. That's where you get your false doctrine of hell, is from the Roman Catholic Church. Okay, I'll bring all this out as I go along, but let me read you Clement's quote here. "We can set no limits to the agency of the Redeemer." That's a capital R talking about Jesus. "The Redeemer to redeem, to rescue, to discipline in his work, and so will he continue to operate after this life." Here we go again. "We can set no limits to the agency of the Redeemer to redeem, to rescue, to discipline in his work, so will he continue." That's Jesus. "Jesus will continue to operate after this life." The next quote, I'm going to go ahead and read this because I've already got it marked, and then I will sign off. This is also from Clement. "When death shall no longer exist, or the sting of death, nor any evil at all, then truly God will be all in all." Well, that was actually Oregon. And here's Clement's. It says, "All men are Christ. They belong to him. Some by knowing him, the rest not yet. He is the Savior, not of some, and not the rest. For how he is Savior and Lord, if not the Savior of all. And he's saying, for how is Jesus the Savior if he is not the Savior and Lord of all? And that's from Clement of Alexandria as well. So I'm going to sign off here, and I'm going to keep pushing here, because guys, we need to believe for a bigger God. We need to believe that God has an unfailing plan for all people, all creation, at some point in this time, sometime, God is going to reconcile everything back to himself, because he is a loving creator who doesn't give up on anything or anybody. I love you, and I'll see you here tomorrow. Bye-bye.